Good evening, and welcome to our next installment of our HBlox is Beyond the Label series, where we've been looking at dyslexia and all the skills that underlie dyslexia. This evening, we're looking at processing as when input does not equal output. Let's just remind ourselves what we've done so far. We've been looking at all the different types of memory, sensory, short-term memory, long-term memory. And we've also looked at the very important skill of concentration and how it affects the whole process of transferring from one memory to the next. This evening, we're looking at perception. Now, all these skills of course, so concentration, perception, memory, logical thinking, work together to form our information processing system. And perception is just one of those skills and is our first skill because that starts when sensory memory comes into play. So what is perception? Now, perception is the process of selecting, organizing, and interpreting information obtained through the senses. And the American Psychological Association defines it as the process of the results of becoming aware of objects and relationships and events by means of the senses, and that includes recognizing, observing, and discriminating. Now, this is very important because when we're reading, recognition and discrimination is really, really important, and also with spelling. And the following processes are used when we first become aware of information. The one is bottom-up processing, and the next is top-down processing. So bottom-up processing means that you're using the perceptual information such as sight, smell, touch, to identify objects. When we use top-down processing, we'd rather use our knowledge, our existing knowledge, and contextual clues, previous experiences to identify an object. Let's just illustrate. If we see an apple, now bottom-up processing would mean it feels quite hard. It is soft to bite into. It is edible. It is roundish in shape, so like a sphere. And all of that will help us identify the type of form we're working with. And when our parents or our teacher then tells us that it's an apple, then we know it's an apple and we've explored it. Top-down processing will say, well, I have experienced an apple before. I've explored it before. I know what it is. So I can, when I see it, I immediately know it's an apple. And I don't have to go and explore the shape and how it feels and how it tastes. Now, similarly, when we read, we use bottom-up processing and top-down processing to learn to read. So when we see a word like sleep, when we first encounter that word, we might explore it by seeing that it has a length of 5 letters. It's got ups, it's got downs, and we're using all our vision. And we can also then see that it has 3 sounds. It's got E, and we can discriminate. When we've encountered the word sleep, the meaning has been explained to us, we understand that that's nighttime rest. The next time we see sleep, we will just recognize it as sleep, and we don't have to explore it again. Now, children that struggle with this skill will struggle to use top-down processing and might continue to rely on bottom-up processing the whole time to be able to identify words and even sounds. So let's look at some of the important perceptual skills that underlie reading and spelling. Firstly, we have our visual and spatial skills. Foreground and background discrimination means that a child is able to discriminate the letters between the background of a page. So if you look at the picture in this slide, a child should be able to identify various different objects in this cup. So firstly, they should be able to see that there's a cup. They should be able to see that there's a pair of scissors, etc. And That would allow them to bring different shapes to the foreground. Color discrimination means that children should be able to discriminate between the black and white on the page, or if they have colored visuals, they should be able to see the different colors in order to disseminate the information. And if you look at this picture, then the word 74 has been embedded inside the slide, and that will show you whether people can actually see the colors. They can't see the number, they might struggle with color discrimination. If you look at size discrimination, different letters have very similar shapes, like the S, and the only difference between a capital and a lowercase is actually the size of the letter. So children that will struggle with size discrimination will struggle, for example, to discriminate between a capital and a small letter S. Then you have shape discrimination. Certain letters look very similar, like an R and an N, an N and an M, A and O, for example, an S and a 5. So lots of children that struggle with shape discrimination will often use these different shapes interchangeably, or might read an N as an R or an R as an N, for example. Then also with different words, they might struggle to discriminate between words like house, hose, and horse, which are very similar shapes, and they might just use them interchangeably. Then if we look at position in space, this is a really important skill. Lots of children, for example, would confuse a B or a D, P and Q. They might confuse an M and a W, an F and a T. So it is shapes that kind of look similar, but their orientation is different. Similar with numbers, a 6 and a 9, a 7 and a 4. Very similar shape, but different orientation, and children might confuse them. If we look at words, the same words like knee and keen, they use exactly the same letters, but in different orders. So again, if a child struggles with position, they will struggle with position of letters in words. Then the same with something like pill and lip. Then even in sentences, children might struggle with the order of words. A child might, for example, read he is fast. He might read is he fast, or the other way around. They might swap the words in the sentence. And apart from changing and confusing similar letters, similar words, or words within sentences, a lot of children actually revert the letter themselves, like the J and the S, a Z, and they would write it the wrong way around. Now, the last perceptual skill is actually visual closure. Visual closure means that the child is able to recognize a letter or a number or a word from just a part of that word. Now, when we read, we often just read the first sound or two, and then we quickly look at the shape, and we quickly look, and we're able to complete that word without actually studying the whole word. Children that struggle with visual closure will struggle to do that. They will want to read each sound and maybe even sound it out to be able to recognize the word as a whole. Another perceptual skill that's important in reading and spelling is the auditory, and particularly in spelling, this will be very important. One of those skills are the ability to discriminate between a letter and a sound. So a child will learn what the letter is, what it looks like, but then they need to match that letter to the sound that it makes. And lots of children confuse, for example, an R and an L. So they might say lied instead of ride. Another shape that often confuses it, and if, so instead of thumb, they might say thumb. A TH as well and a T, so instead of saying with, they might say wit, sh, and s. So a lot of children would spell a word like shop, they will spell as sop. And then the same with an M and an N. Word sound discrimination as well. There's a lot of words that are very similar, like 70 and 17, clothes, cloths, clothes. So children need to listen very carefully to know which of those words you mean, and often they will use contextual clues. But children that struggle might write the wrong word or hear the wrong word. Then we have synthesis and analysis. When we read and spell, we need to be able to take apart the different sounds in a word and then blend them again to write. And particularly in reading, you're going to have to blend them to be able to recognize the word as a whole. So in terms of synthesis, a child might sound a word out and analyze them correctly as at, but then be unable to put those separate sounds together, blend them to read them, and might read something like cold, which has nothing to do with the individual letters. In terms of analysis, children need to be able to, for example, identify a beginning sound, middle sound, end sound, be able to manipulate sounds, so be able to recognize that if you take a word like flat and you want to change it to pat, you need to change the beginning sound from the f sound to the p sound. And the same, to go from pat to part, you need to insert an R. Then also, children that struggle with analysis will struggle to be able to read words in syllables. Particularly the older children that need to read longer, more complex words often struggle with simplification. So they might spell temperature as temperature because they can't hear this temperature, temperature. Then if we look at strategies for developing these skills to make sure that your child can read and spell effectively, you can start from a really young age. And there's a lot of worksheets available on different websites. Now, some of these are the ones that I've just shown you for foreign background discrimination, for color discrimination. If you look at those eggs, they all look the same. The only difference is the colors. So to be able to match them, you need to discriminate color. Size discrimination, very similar pictures. The one is just bigger than the other one. Shape discrimination, so you can see the V in different orientations, and they need to be able to recognize them. That also runs together with your position in shape, that you need to be able to recognize the position in the shape. So you've got the visual perception, position space specific ones like the left and the right, the birds that are the different way around. Those two really go together, the shape discrimination, the position in shape space. And then you have your visual closure, where part of the word has been rubbed out and you need to fill it back in. Okay. Then we look at the auditory perception, where you can use these types of sounds that we know are confusing to children, and we can turn them into games. For example, you can use ask a child to tell you which sound they hear. So if I say a word, I want you to clap. For example, on an R, I want you to tap on the table if you hear the sound L. So you can just say lots of different words and your child either have to clap or they have to pat. You can do similar with all of those. You can also have cards for each sound, and the child needs to hold up the card of the sound that you're saying. And the same with the words. You can say different words in a sentence, and the child needs to pick up the card or the picture of the card that matches that word. Another one is, we've come to your blending and your synthesis and analysis. You can ask children to really sound out words. And a very good way of sounding out words, instead of saying something like cat is k-at, you might say k-at, so that actually the sound continues, and it helps a child to blend, because while they're analyzing, they're actually blending at the same time. So you can show them a card, and they need to sound that word out by actually blending it at the same time. So if we take like pat, I need to say p-at, pat. You can get children to really identify beginning end sounds. If I say, I want you to tell me, if I say an S, whether it's in the beginning, whether it's in the middle, or whether it's in the end. Or you can tell them a word and say, I want you to identify the beginning sound of that word, and I want you to identify the end sound of that word, or the middle sound of that word. Sound manipulation, the same. Rhyming words are amazing for that. So you can say to the child, I want you to get a sound, a word that would rhyme with rat. So rat, rap, rack, and then different words that would sound with the end. So if I have rat, sat, fat. So that's where you can do lots of different rhyme words. Then you also, you can get the older children to clap out syllables. So you can give them a word like table, and they need to say table. So they clap twice. If it is philosophy, which is a much harder word, they need to answer philosophy and clap it out. So that helps the children to really hear the different syllables that's in the word and the different sound parts of the word. So we've looked at the sensory processing. We've looked at the recognition and discrimination. Now, all the information that we decide is important and that needs to go into the long-term memory is then written into the short-term memory in either a visual picture or into a phonological loop, which basically means that is a repetition of what has been heard. So your written information, for example, a text, is normally transferred into a phonological loop where we say that to ourselves over and over and over again to remember it. Whereas pictures like a bird would then be stored as a picture if I see it. Taste often is associated with a picture, like if I taste an apple, I'm going to see an apple, and it's going to be encoded into a picture. Now, to take that to the long-term memory, it's important that we go through the working memory, because a short-term memory is a holding cell. It holds information, but it can't process information. So let's have a look at the working memory. That's probably the most important memory. And because it's actually processing, that's why we're doing it tonight rather than with the memory. Now, we can illustrate this with this following two examples. The one is, what shape is this? Now, this shape, we have said we can discriminate. We can say it's got six corners. It's got lots of different edges. And we can explore it as a box and name it as a box. Or we can just use our top-down processing to say we've actually encountered a box before. We recognize this as a box. But it's simply recognizing it. There's nothing we need to understand about it, especially if we've explored it before. So we can just remember this as a box. If we look at this following example, where we're asking, are the horizontal lines sloped or straight? Now, I can't just recognize this as, yes, it's straight, or yes, it's sloped, because it's quite confusing. I'm going to have to use a little bit more information. I'm going to have to look at my knowledge of a rectangle to know that all the opposite sides are equal, which means that the two shorter sides must be equal. We need to use our knowledge of fractions to say that each of those rows have been, or each of the sides have been split into five equal lengths, which means that if they're equal, those horizontal lines have to be straight, even though the different blocks that's been put in there makes it confusing and makes it look like it's sloped. So we need to do a level of manipulation. And like we said, that manipulation cannot take place in the short-term memory. So that's where the working memory comes in. Now, the working memory is really the information control center for our higher cognitive functions. So it is a kind of memory in the sense that it holds information. But It is also the place where higher cognitive functions take place, which is basically our processing center. Now, the working memory, therefore, allows us to do thinking, comprehension, reasoning, judgments, decision-making. All the skills are important to be able to process information into our long-term memory effectively. It's a function of the prefrontal cortex, and that's very important because most of our learning and memorizing takes place in the hippocampus. That it regulates learning, memory, it encodes memory, it consolidates memory, and it also does our spatial navigation. But that is, like we talked about, the short-term memory. That is just information. It's not actually manipulating the information to solve problems or to find links, etc. For that, we need our working memory. Now, the amygdala is also a very important area in our brain because that's where we navigate our emotions, our emotional behavior, and our motivation. So also a very important part of the brain. But the prefrontal cortex are particularly important because that is where all our higher cognitive functioning are lying. Okay. Now, the working memory consists of various different parts. It consists of our visual spatial sketchpad and our phonological loop, like as we said, that's kind of part of our short-term memory. And then it also contains our long-term memory. And it links our short-term memory and our long-term memory with this episodic buffer. So the episodic buffer is what makes our working memory particularly important, because the episodic buffer is almost like a train station where trains from different areas coincide, and is the coming and going of this information is controlled, or the trains are controlled. So it's almost like your air traffic controller on your airport. And this coming and going of information allows us to simultaneously bring in new information into our short-term memory and connect that with information in our long-term memory. It can also bring information in from our long-term memory to work with the new information that's coming through our short-term memory. So it almost is a loading and unloading zone of information. And that is for new information. So when new information comes in, we need to link it with our long-term memory. So we bring out knowledge that we already know to make those links, and then we store it and organizing it back into our long-term memory. But it's also important when we're actually doing problem solving, especially, for example, mathematics, when we need to problem solve, we need to bring prior knowledge out to be able to solve a problem that comes in new. So we optimize our existing knowledge, we apply it to new contexts to solve problems. Now, all of this needs something to control it. You can imagine if the episodic buffer is just a place, it's just a memory. So something needs to control what should come in and what should go out and how long it should stay there and what we should do with that information. And that is our central executive. Now, the central executive is like a conductor. You'll see the picture of a conductor. You've got all the different instruments that play together, and the conductor tells you which one plays when and how it should play. So the central executive does the following in our brains. It directs our attention. So it tells us what we should focus on. It maintains task goals. So if you have a problem, let's just imagine our work problem in mathematics. We have a goal. We have an end answer that we need to get to. And your central executive will keep you focused on that end goal so that you don't get as distracted by other pieces of information. It helps you with decision making. So which information should I bring in? What information should I link that with? It makes those decisions. It organizes our thinking. So when all this information comes in, it helps us to think sequentially through that information. And in the memory retrieval, like we said, when you know what information you need, it then has to go and retrieve that correct information. So in short, it focuses our attention. It helps us to divide our attention between two concurrent tasks. and it helps us to switch from one task to another. So if you think a little bit about the attention webinar we had, it's almost very similar to our focus attention, divided attention, and alternating attention. So the two are very much blended. Why is working memory so important? We can call working memory the engine of our brain. And like I said in our previous example, that's where all our processing really takes place. The information taken to our long-term memory and then retrieved to be able to manipulate and problem solve. And the link between attention is clear. So it helps learners to pay attention to and pay attention to the right information. It assists us to become fluent readers. If you just think about the words and things that we talked about in our perception, when you read, you need to understand what that word means that you're reading. You need to link it to our previous reading. You need to link it to what's coming. And if you reach an unfamiliar word, you need to be able to use your contextual clues to identify that word. And that is all linked to our working memory, because we need to use old information and blend it with new information. Reading comprehension, I mean, that's self-explanatory. To make sense of it, you need all those skills of all that existing knowledge about the world and about different themes to be able to make sense of new information that comes in. Mental maths, we've basically talked about that. You need to be able to hold information in your brain while you are manipulating other pieces of information. And problem solving, we've talked a lot about. And then it helps learners, of course, to reach the full potential. If your working memory is poor, you can't really make sense of the world around you. And even success in sports, strategic thinking. I mean, you are, if you're able to throw a ball, brilliant, you can probably play a position in sports. But if you don't know when I should kick the ball and when I shouldn't, and when I should gain territory and when I should try and score, then you're going to struggle with the game. Now, poor working memory is very much associated with learning difficulties, because a child that struggles to make sense will struggle to understand concepts, and particularly more complex concepts. Okay. Now, like we said, all the skills that we've worked on so far, concentration, perception, memory, and logical thinking, which we're going to look at next week, forms our information processing system. And if any of those skills are poor, if you can't concentrate, you're going to struggle with working memory. Because working memory really is directing your attention. If you can't concentrate, how can it direct? We talked about perception. If you can't discriminate correctly, then you're going to be working on the incorrect information. You need to know what you're working with. You need to be able to identify it. And a lot of children struggle with that. When they see a sum, they might misread that sum. And then any work that you do on that sum is going to be incorrect. Memory, the working memory works between your long-term memory and your short-term memory. So if either of those memories are not well developed, you're going to struggle with the flow of information between the two memories and keeping the information in your memory long enough to be able to manipulate it. And logical reasoning, we're going to talk about a lot in our next webinar, but it links with comprehension. If you can't understand, if you cannot reason, then you're going to struggle to be able to use the information in your working memory effectively to be able to problem solve. So if your child struggles with any of the cognitive skills that we've talked about, EduBlocks can help. EduBlocks is a scientifically developed program that helps children that struggle with reading, spelling, maths, and learning. And we use structured exercises to do that. EduBlocks has been existent for more than 35 years, and we have lots of about 40 plus franchises all through the country. We've helped hundreds and I could even say thousands of children to consolidate their foundational skills and to improve their reading, their spelling, their mathematics, and their learning, and generally their working memory. We don't only help children that struggle, we also help children that do well already to even become stronger, therefore accelerating their learning and excelling. Our program makes smart learners smarter. So please, if your child is struggling, contact us, look at our website, edublocks.co.za. You can also read a lot of our success stories that parents have shared with us voluntarily. And you can go and read their stories of hope. Maybe you'll find parents that have traveled the same journey as you have and that have found help at EduBlocks. Please don't be hesitant to contact your nearest EduBlocks and they can help you. Thank you for listening.